We toured Yellowstone National Park for 5 long and fascinating days to locate the most scenic and biologically meaningful sites. We will start this video with a short tour to give you a feeling for the various landscapes. Unfortunately, we won't be able to include the smell of the sulfur, the freezing dawns, the taste of the s'mores on the fire in the evening, and the sound of the hail on our tent at night. We were inspired by the beautiful book of Bruce Falk and Tom Murphy, The Art of Yellowstone Science. In the introduction they write, "Art and science both originate from the same human desire to understand the world within and around us. Where did we come from? How did we get here? Why are we here? Where are we going?" To seek answers, science requires inspiration from art, just as art yearns for understanding from science. This dynamic drives imagination and motivates curiosity. This quote summarizes not only our visit to Yellowstone, but our entire course. You will realize that curiosity, sense of beauty, creativity and imagination all originate from sexual reproduction. We attempted to produce a course that will embrace all these aspects and will present the beauty and mystery of nature, that will stimulate your imagination and inspire your creativity. We are standing by the lower waterfall of the Yellowstone River that gave the park its name, Yellowstone. A large part of the park is a huge caldera of a collapsed supervolcano. Many of the phenomena we see here are due to rainwater that penetrated fractures in the crust, were heated and erupted silently or with great noise in geysers, fumaroles, hot springs or bubbling mud pools. Here one can vividly perceive that we live on a very thin crust. Everything might explode any minute. However, as you are watching the video, you understand that we made it home safely. We are here in Yellowstone Park in the USA, and behind me is the most iconic geyser of all geysers in the world, the Old Faithful, which will erupt soon and we will see it now. The reason we came here is twofold. The first reason is that this is the first national park ever to be dedicated in the world and represents what many see as the finest American idea of national parks and of nature protection and preservation. Indeed, this place is very, very rich in megafauna, maybe the richest in any place of the world outside of Africa. We have bisons, we have elk, we have wolves, bears, deer and many other animals, and we will see them here. The second reason we came here is that this place represents a window into our ancient past as living creatures. Long before sex appeared with eukaryotic cells, with compound cells, our planet was inhabited only by bacteria and archaea. Bacteria and archaea, which eventually formed the compound cells, lived in conditions which are very extreme, like the ones we see here. We have very hot springs here, close to boiling temperature, very acidic, very special conditions. And we will see them here in different parts of the park, which has about 10,000 different thermal wells, geysers, mud pots, and so on.
Yellowstone offers not only a fascinating glance beneath the crust we live on, but also a peep into our most ancient past. Our planet is about 4.5 billion years old, and life appeared on it about 4 billion years ago. We are, however, far from understanding how. One of the most popular hypotheses surmises that this happened in hot springs at the bottom of the ocean. Visiting these springs is beyond the budget of our course. But here in Mammoth Hot Springs in North Yellowstone, we can witness similar geological events that happen just in front of our eyes and at very rapid pace. This water was rain thousands of years ago. On its long way down and up through the layers of rock, it dissolved various minerals. When this hot solution re-emerges, it deposits travertine. Travertine can be found in stalactite caves and in your kettle. But here its pace of deposition is unparalleled, and it forms little pools. After erupting, the water gradually cools, and its acidity changes. The variable properties of the water in these pools forms an array of habitats for unique forms of life that paint the rocks in vivid colors. These forms are the basis of an entire food chain. During most of its history, our planet was inhabited only by bacteria. As funny as it might sound, we came here to see bacteria. It is funny, as bacteria can be found everywhere. Our body contains huge numbers of them. However, in most cases they remain invisible to the naked eye. Here, in contrast, it is possible to see them and virtually do a bacterial safari. For example, here in Great Prismatic Spring, the largest hot spring in America, we can walk by immense bacterial mats. Up to 40 years ago, it was assumed that bacteria are a single group, all small and structurally simple cells lacking internal organelles that were produced by binary fission. Developing molecular sequencing methods enabled Karl Woese, the most famous scientist you have never heard about, to discover that bacteria are in fact two distinct groups, archaea and true bacteria. Like many other revolutionary scientists, Woese and his ideas met much disbelief and even hostility from the rest of the scientific community. However, his ideas are now widely accepted. The meaning of the name archaea is ancient creatures, like archaeology, the science of ancient artifacts. Many archaea live in environments of extreme temperature, acidity and salinity, like in the hot springs here at Norris Basin. If I would fall into one of these pools, I would be cooked alive within a few minutes. The second group, true bacteria, we know very well. For example, in our body, especially in our digestive system, there are many different types of bacteria. It is estimated that the number of bacteria in our body equals that of our own cells. We are used to think about bacteria as pathogens. However, the number of types that cause disease is rather small. In fact, without bacteria that help us to digest our food, we would have a hard time to survive. Ruminators, like these mule deer, are even more dependent on bacteria to digest the grass they eat. In the hot and boiling springs here, there are many bacteria that are resistant to extreme conditions. Some of them use solar energy for photosynthesis, a process during which water molecules are split, leading to the release of oxygen. The ancestors of these bacteria are responsible for the oxygenation of our atmosphere. It is possible to identify the different bacteria by the color of the mats they generate. One of the reasons for the orange color are carotenoids, the bacteria produced to protect themselves from solar radiation, like sunscreen. A similar compound can be found in tomatoes and carrots, as well as in leaves of trees. In fall, when the green chlorophyll in the leaves is broken down before leaves are shed, this color appears in all its glory. From bacteria that grow here, scientists have extracted heat-resistant proteins. The entire biotech industry is based on these proteins, as are most medical and forensic diagnostic methods in the entire genome sequencing endeavor. You might wonder why we are talking about bacteria. After all, this course is about sex, and bacteria don't reproduce by sex. Sex is unique to eukaryotes. Many of you might hear the term eukaryote for the first time. In this course, I will go out of my way to use as little scientific jargon as only possible. However, eukaryote is too important a term to skip. First of all, because you, if you didn't know, are eukaryotes. And second, because eukaryotes produce by sex, which makes them the actors of our course. Eukaryotes mean real nucleus, and eukaryotes indeed have a cell nucleus. All multicellular organisms, animals, plants and fungi are eukaryotes. There are also plenty of unicellular eukaryotes, like the yeast, that make our daily bread and beer. Most unicellular eukaryotes, like the malaria parasite, belongs to the kingdom Protista. Organisms that lack a nucleus, bacteria and archaea, are called prokaryotes. Prokaryotes and eukaryotes have many common features, but we will mention only two. The first is that all cells have a membrane that separates them from the environment. This membrane is fully penetrable to certain substances, like water. The permeation of other substances, like certain types of salt, is regulated. Many other substances cannot enter the cell at all. This membrane enables the cell to regulate its internal environment and keep it different from the external one. The second feature common to all organisms that live today is that they all encode their genetic information in a similar manner. How exactly, we'll see in the second lesson. Both in nature and the lab, very different creatures can therefore exchange information. We are thus all parts of a huge family emanating long ago from a common ancestor. As we are all related, it is our responsibility as the most intelligent sibling to care for all other life. After talking about features common to eukaryotes and prokaryotes, we will now briefly discuss the differences. Eukaryotic cells are, as a rule, much larger than bacteria. They also have an array of internal organelles lacking in bacteria. The most prominent one is the nucleus that gave them their name. Eukaryote means real nucleus. The second important organelle is the mitochondrion that generates most of the energy of the cell. This is Lynn Margulis, who suggested that eukaryotic cells formed when one type of bacteria moved into a second one. This endosymbiotic theory is now widely accepted, but when Margulis first suggested it, she met with much contempt and hostility. The mitochondria originated most likely from an oxygen-consuming true bacterium. The host that developed into the eukaryotic cell was probably an archaeon. Indeed, Rose already observed that eukaryotes have characteristics of both bacteria and archaea. This tree of life depicts that eukaryotes are the descendants of both bacteria and archaea, and represents our current understanding of the evolution of life. Let us conclude our visit here with the biggest eukaryote in America, the bison. We are here in the Ramal Valley in Yellowstone National Park. Behind me is a big herd of bisons. Bisons used to be a very, very abundant animal. Millions of it roamed the prairies of North America. Unfortunately, most of them were exterminated and they were became almost extinct by the mid-19th century. In 1880, a ranch here was built in order to restore the population. There were no bisons here then, and today Lamar Valley and bisons are almost one and the same.